I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Ken Platt's Gymkhana Foul Play. The Princess Stakes Murder. Starring Howard Duff. Julie Adams. And Ray Danton. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
The Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
Chevrolet and State Farm Insurance. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
This week's story takes us into the fascinating realm of horses, jockeys, big money, big passions, the racetrack. We are about to meet Max Roper, private detective, and a good one. He's a man with a style. Subtlety isn't part of it. He's a gut reaction operative who acts upon what he calls feelings. If given the choice, one would be better off as his friend rather than an enemy. Max Roper had a friend, a little friend. A jockey, and a good one. Some called him the best. But sometimes the best just isn't good enough, especially when you're dead. Our story, The Princess Stakes Murder, begins after this word.
There in the stretch, Jen Calamity has the lead. Humble Hilda holding back. Sister Sally moving up. It's Sister Sally and Calamity. Calamity stepping out, pulling away. It's Calamity by a length.
It's always nice to win, even when you bet on the favorite. It was a big win all around. For Calamity, her owner, the trainer, but mostly for Willie Rich, the veteran jockey and an old friend of mine. I'd driven down to Del Mar from L.A. because of Willie, as a matter of fact. He'd called me the night before, wanted to see me. Nothing special, he'd said. I played it close, put down $2 on him, made 80 cents. But Willie wasn't around after the race like he said he'd be. That didn't make any sense at all. So I asked Allie Regal about it. Regal used to be a top government agent. Now he was chief of Del Mar security. Hey, Allie.
Max, what's up? Hey, you're a long way from home.
Well, not much. Came down to watch Willie ride.
That's worth the trip.
Yeah, you see him?
Saw him in the winner's circle.
After that?
After that? Well, no, that's funny.
What's funny?
I don't remember seeing Willie dress or nothing. You know, these little guys maybe got lost.
Yeah. I was bugged on the drive back to L.A. and not just from the Labor Day traffic. Willie was a little guy, all right, but he walked tall and always said what he meant. And he'd said he wanted to see me. I had the uneasy feeling that there was a reason for Willie not meeting me after the eighth race. Men in my line of work get those feelings sometimes. 7 o'clock the next morning, my telephone started jumping out of the cradle. 18. 19. 20. 21. Yeah. I'll never get in shape this way. Roper here.
Max, it's Ollie.
Yeah. Hear from Willie?
Heard from his wife.
She hear from him?
Saw him. He don't swim near as good as he rides.
Give it to me, Ollie.
Well, it seems she went for a little midnight swim in their pool. Nearly landed on him.
Was he dead already?
Very.
Thanks, Ollie. Hang around, will you? I'm on my way.
From what I was told, you could hear her screaming for 8 miles. I got there at 1 a.m. The track physician, Dr. Taniguchi, figures that Willie died somewhere between 10 and 11.
Let's start with the obvious. His wife giving him a hard time?
He wouldn't have killed himself over that. I can't see Penny wanting him out of the way either. He let her roam, didn't he? He was always worth more booting home than winners. Now, why would she want him dead?
Yeah, maybe she wants the pool all to herself when she gets home late nights. The owner, Tyler Clayton, what can you tell me about him?
Let's see, he owns Calamity and several other nags. Tough, pig-headed man. He wants what he wants when he wants it.
Well, he been his rider for long?
About 5 years.
Must have made Clayton a lot of money.
Sure, but Clayton doesn't need it.
I'll run over and see him. Maybe I'll find out what a rich guy like that really needs. Instead of going right to the Claytons, I decided to start with Willie Rich's widow, Penny. Willie's spread was at the end of a humpback dirt and gravel lane. It was expensive. Willie had booted home a lot of winners in his time and could afford the layout. The flashy little blonde at the far end of the pool, wearing very little of a strawberry bikini, looked like the most expensive bit of landscaping. She was wearing enormous sunglasses, smoking a joint. Mrs. Rich, my name is Max Roper. Maybe Willie mentioned my name. We were friends.
Everybody that calls says he was a friend of Willie's.
Well, he was a popular guy. Can you tell me anything about it?
What's to tell? He's dead, drowned in his own swimming pool.
Well, I'm trying to find out who had it in for Willie.
Who are you?
Private investigator. I'm here because Willie was a friend of mine. I want to find out who knocked him off.
That's a crock. For all anybody knows, Willie did it himself.
Well, why would he do that?
Ask him. We didn't talk much.
A man doesn't kill himself just because his marriage isn't worth it.
Why don't you get lost?
Maybe somebody was trying to pressure him into something, you know. Maybe they were worrying him.
They? Who's they?
I was hoping you'd tell me, Mrs. Rich.
Go to hell and don't bother to come back.
I'll drop in again sometime when you're over your grief. As I approached my car, a man was just getting out of his. Husky, dark-haired, pallid, a clothes horse. His features rough and crude, but not anywhere near his own real personality. We'd never been formally introduced, but I was well acquainted with his reputation. Johnny Cascio, a reliable enforcer for the mob. We brushed shoulders as he walked by, and he flipped his hand in salute. I half expected there'd be a knife in it. If he was a friend of the widow Rich, he was moving in too fast for my taste. I sat in my car for a minute just thinking. Then I looked into my rearview mirror. Johnny Cascio had stopped. He was standing there, watching me. Rancho Santa Fe is a serene valley catering to the extreme tastes of millionaires, horse lovers who like their pictures taken in the winner's circle. Tyler C. Clayton was the millionaire I wanted to see. He stood an easy 6'5 or 6, went about 250. The man was a real big daddy.
I liked Willie, Mr. Roper. Liked having him work for me. Damn good jockey. What did he drink?
Bourbon. You think Willie drowned himself, Mr. Clayton?
Hell no. Why would he do that? Big money-winning rider, good for a lot of years.
Maybe you can give me a line on Willie's enemies.
Enemies? He didn't have a one. Everybody liked Willie. Here you go.
Thank you. Somebody didn't. Drowning a guy isn't exactly a demonstration of friendship.
Sure wish I could help you.
Clayton's eyes strayed past me. I turned my head and saw why. A woman had appeared in the open doorway. A strawberry blonde in her late 30s, quite beautiful, wearing expensive casual threads. As she acknowledged the introduction to me, she put her hand gracefully to her throat. A small gesture that triggered something in my memory.
Oh, dear. Perhaps we should speak to Mr. Roper. Mr. Regal recommended him.
No, Monica, I don't think there's any need to...
Please, Tyler.
All right. If you have to, spill it.
Mr. Roper, we have a problem. It's Tyler's daughter, Pamela. She's been missing since yesterday.
I'm sorry to hear that. How old is the girl?
22.
That makes her old enough.
Old enough for what?
To leave home.
She had a beauty appointment, a health spa in Poway called the Gilded Cuckoo. But she never got there.
Have you notified the police?
No.
Any particular reason why not, Mr. Clayton? I mean, your daughter disappearing the same day Willie Rich was murdered?
What are you implying?
Well, I'm not trying to worry you, but that's the line the police would take.
Are you suggesting that Pamela's been kidnapped?
No, but Well, somebody could have tried to coerce you about a horse and got even because you wouldn't give in.
Just you find her and stop asking so damn many fool questions. I don't believe a damn word you're saying, and that's the last time... that's the last you're going to get out of me.
I'm sorry, Mr. Roper.
No, it's all right. You have a picture of the girl, Mrs. Clayton?
Right over there, in the silver frame.
By the way, was that your mare, Sister Sally, that got beaten by Calamity, your husband's filly?
Calamity didn't beat her. Willie Rich did.
Would you say that would be reason enough for you to kill Willie, Mrs. Clayton?
No, Mr. Roper. I wouldn't.
The Gilded Cuckoo in Poway only proved that business in narcissism was booming. These out-of-town spas were good for kicking habits with drugs and booze high up on the list, followed by weight and body conditioning for cosmetic vanity. I was leafing through folders that listed available courses without the humdrum detail of prices when the director pranced in.
Oh, Mr. Roper, I'm George Glendon. I direct the activities of our little sanctuary. Now, how might we help you?
Well, I like to eat, drink, and I sit around a lot. How long would it take to put me in shape?
Well, that all depends on your cooperation. See, with our program, your muscles may scream and tell you that you're being tortured. But believe me, they're going to tone up. See, we believe in the brain, the body, and the soul, all stimulated and fused into creativity and love to attain the perfect body.
I'll buy that, but how long does it take?
Well, there's Plan A. It's a 12-lesson course. Oh, we do marvelous work with ozone treatment and face vacuuming.
Face vacuuming?
That's what I said. Face vacuuming. Self-love, my liege, is not so vile as self-neglect. And that's Henry V. You know, Shakespeare?
Yes, I know.
Well, why don't we look around? Now, you'll be able to decide far easier after you've seen our facilities.
The look around was a revelation. A fully equipped gym that didn't smell any better than my gym in Santa Monica. Mineral springs, baths, face packs, men and women hovered over by attendants, and a plastic surgery wing. Then we zeroed in on something called the isotron room. Through a one-way mirror, Glendon and I looked into a bare room furnished with only a long white couch and a machine called the isotron. The man lying on the couch was stripped down to his trunks. Contact pads ran from his body to the machine. A man wearing a white coat flipped the switch, and the face of the man on the couch contorted. The pads covering his body jiggled. His arms, shoulders, back, stomach, and leg muscles went into massive contractions.
The man in the white coat is our isotron specialist, Dr. Savage.
Well, that figures.
There is no pain. No, it is the body's natural reaction.
Yeah. What happens if that guy in the white coat falls asleep during a session?
Well, then we'd have a very well-developed corpse. But, of course, that would never happen. See, it's all automatic. Now, do you perhaps have any questions?
Yes, one. It's about Miss Pamela Clayton.
Are you a friend of the Claytons?
More like a friend of a friend. I understand Pamela had an appointment with her hairstylist yesterday at 10:30, and she canceled out. Would you know anything about it?
Is this important?
I'd say so. She's been missing for 24 hours. I happened to be in the neighborhood and told Mr. and Mrs. Clayton I'd check it out.
Well, then why don't we find out? I'd like to look at your appointment book, Miss Hill. Yesterday morning, you said?
Yes, about 10:30.
Well, there must be some mistake. Miss Clayton wasn't scheduled for an appointment. See, at 10:30, we have a Mr. H. Masson down for Mr. K. That's Miss Clayton's usual hairdresser. Well, here, see for yourself.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks. Sorry I troubled you.
No trouble at all. I don't suppose we'll be seeing you again, Mr. Roper.
Oh, I wouldn't say that. A lot of what I saw here interests me. I might be back sooner than you think. I stood outside as the gilded doors closed behind me. That isopron machine in there, twisting and turning the human being into a shapeless mass. Whether it built muscles or not, I didn't know. But there was one thing I was sure of. It could tear a man apart. The sun warmed my back. Horses stomped lazily in their stalls. I was looking for Joey Zale, a jockey that had been thrown only once, and that one time enough to end his career. I found Joey Zale cleaning a stall. I noticed his hands as he lit a cigarette. They were huge. Above the waist, Zale was a middleweight. Only his crippled legs were pipe-stem thin. His face and body carried a twisted snarl. You Joey Zale?
Yeah. What are you, the Heat?
Private Dick. Willie Rich is a friend of mine.
Too bad it didn't do him any good.
Can we talk?
Talk.
Do you think Willie killed himself?
If he did, he could have done it right here. He didn't need no pool. He hated water.
Could he swim?
It's hard if somebody's holding your head under.
Good point, Joey. Who did it to him?
I heard of you, Roper. I know your scene. Hell, if you don't know who did it to Willie, we all got trouble.
I need a lead, Joey. Anything. Anybody.
You got one already.
Willie's wife?
I don't think so. You've been to Clayton's, haven't you?
You mean the daughter, Pam?
Nah, you're cooking. Only don't ask me why, because I don't know.
Were they close? Willie and Pam Clayton?
That's your business. Find out.
Joey Zale was right. It was my business. I started out by trying to find the H. Masson who had Pam Clayton's 10:30 appointment at the Gilded Cuckoo. No dice, no listing, no nothing. I called the Claytons. They were out, and the Scandinavian maid told me Pam hadn't come back. I was going in a circle, so I decided to get home and start over again. When I walked into my apartment in Santa Monica, the phone was ringing. Roper here.
Max, Allie Regal. Say, I heard something about Willie and Pam Clayton.
Like what?
Like maybe they had a thing for each other.
So I've heard. Tell me something about Mrs. Clayton.
What's to tell? A lot of money, doesn't like a stepdaughter.
Yeah. Something else, Allie. I got the strangest feeling I know her.
Of course you do. It's Monica Moore. Pretty big movie star 15 years ago. Mostly B pictures. Her career went down the drain. Men, mostly. A lot of booze, maybe some drugs. A few bad marriages.
Thanks, Allie. Let me know if you get a lead on Pam Clayton, will you?
Yeah, I was going to ask you to do the same.
After I hung up, I called on a theatrical agent pal of mine, Sid Pinter. Asked him what he could tell me about Monica Moore. I struck gold. He had a complete file on her. A stack of old 8x10 publicity stills. She's been out of pictures a long time, Sid. How come you have these photos?
Me? I'm a string saver. I save junk, memories.
This picture, who's the guy with
her? Oh, that's Johnny Hunter, her first husband. Family owned part of Texas and half of Wyoming. Here's number two, the cowboy star, Rex Lennox.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that didn't last long. And this is number three, the hotel man. You know, Chilson, Charles Chilson.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, she got a big bundle from him. And this is number four, Muscles. Lance Kite, former Mr. America, Mr. Universe.
I suppose that one didn't last long either.
Nah, all he had was his muscle flexing act. Well, after him, it was all downhill for Monica. She quit show business. Got into religion instead. Astral and cosmic magnetism. You should excuse the expression. I'm trying to think of the guy's name. Let's see, it was Charnick. Yeah, Lewis Charnick. He gave public lectures. Helped you find the miracle in your life. You know, that kind of nonsense.
Monica Moore joined up with Charnick?
Well, it was more like she backed him. You know, a lot of people take that stuff seriously. Anyway, that's about all I know. I haven't heard a word from or about her since.
She's in Clover, Sid. Big oil man, number five, Tyler Clayton.
Oh, well, I'm glad. She was a beautiful kid. They racked her up good in this town. You know, the scandal nearly ruined her.
What scandal?
The first husband killed himself.
Johnny Hunter?
Yeah. Sleeping pills, overdosed.
Yeah. Is this China character still operating?
I see his name in the paper time to time.
Thanks, Sid. See you around.
Yeah, well, don't thank me. Every time you come here for some cockamamie information, somebody jumps you and knocks your head in.
Not this time. I'm investigating the death of Willie Rich.
The jockey? What's Monica Moore got to do with that?
I don't know. Maybe nothing. It's just that Monica's stepdaughter disappeared the same day Willie Rich was murdered. I'm trying to find out who killed Willie and locate the girl.
You should live so long.
I was nursing a beer in my digs a little later, and I was flipping through the entertainment section of a loaf of sheet, wondering how I was going to kill the evening when I came across the ad. Charnock, tonight, Wilshire Playhouse, 8 o'clock. There was a picture of Charnock on the wall in the playhouse lobby. He looked young, tall, dark, and handsome. The lights dimmed, and a chunky, broad-shouldered man dressed in white came out of the wings and sat down at the organ. Then the spotlight came on, and Charnock appeared. He wasn't young like the picture in the lobby, around 50. His eyes were dark, intense, his voice mellifluous, and he knew how to use it. Didn't waste a word. He knew where the money was. The large audience was still and attentive. When the lecture was over, I got out as fast as I could. I waited near the alley where I could watch the back entrance. A big black limousine was parked there, a burly, tough-looking driver behind the wheel. In a few minutes, Charnock came out, got into the car, and it started forward. As it slowly passed by, I saw there was a passenger in the back seat. A female passenger, none other than Monica Clayton. So, Charnock and Monica, and Willie Rich and Pam Clayton. Two here, and two gone. I was getting another one of those feelings. Didn't like it much. It felt like murder, with more to come.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Princess Stakes Murder. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. On Labor Day, jockey Willie Rich rode home, the favorite, for a big win at Del Mar Racetrack. He celebrated by turning up the next morning in his swimming pool, dead. An accident? Private Detective Max Roper doesn't think so. He has the feeling that it was murder, and has set out to prove just that to Tyler Clayton, oil man, horse owner, and the late jockey's employer, whose debutante daughter is missing, to Clayton's wife, Monica, a former B-picture movie star with a string of ex-husbands and an involvement with a metaphysical quack named Louis Charnock, and to a health spa that features a machine called the Isotron, a machine that Max Roper has the feeling could break a man in half. The Princess Stakes Murder resumes after this message.
It was Tuesday morning, and I was back at the EPT offices on Wilshire Boulevard, EPT meaning Emergency Procedure Terminus. It stands for Big Troubles and the Solutions Thereof. My boss asked me how my weekend was. I told him. I told him, too, that Willie was a friend of mine. He gave me 1 week to wrap the whole thing up. I started at LAPD. Captain Scott, head of Bunko and Forgery, didn't keep me waiting, and I didn't waste his time.
Charnock? Louis Charnock? We've had an eye on him for 20 years. There have been a few complaints, but nothing we could hit him with and make it stick. You know this town, it's always gone for quacks and saviors.
What kind of complaints?
Then again, you'd be surprised how many people swear that Charnock's given them inspiration and reason for living.
I repeat, what kind of complaints?
Standard. He gets good play with donations. There's another man in the operation, Wesley Dorn, works with Charnock. Does bookings, takes care of travel, publicity, promotion, greets the little old ladies, plays the organ background music.
Yeah, I saw him. Chunky, broad-shouldered, dressed all in white. What about him?
Well, Dorn handles the money end. Keeps Charnock always in the clear.
Always?
Well, we nearly had him nailed 7 years ago.
Dorn or Charnock?
It doesn't matter. I see it as Charnock's operation. Anyway, 7 years back, a fella claimed Charnock broke up his marriage. Claimed a 529.
Extortion?
Yeah. But the wife refused to sign the complaint. The guy claimed that half the dough his wife shelled out was his. Community property.
Sounds more like a civil action. Did he get half the money back?
It was his wife's income. He wasn't working. Apparently, he settled out of court.
The guy ever get his wife back?
Nope.
What was his name? You might be able to give me a line.
Lance Kite.
Number four. Do you have Kite's last address in that file?
I'll write it down.
Okay. Now to get back to Willie Rich.
I checked with homicide. So far, his death is listed as an accidental drowning.
I'm trying to prove otherwise. And I got another problem. Pam Clayton, missing heiress. Here's her picture and statistics.
Girl, that pretty ought to be right up your alley, Roper. Shouldn't take you more than a few days.
How do you figure? I haven't got much to go on.
Sure you have. Incentive.
Lance Kite had moved from the address he'd given the Bunko Squad. He was now living in an apartment house in a ratty section of West Los Angeles with a good view of the city's storm drain. Whatever Monica's out-of-court settlement had been, it was no windfall.
Yeah.
I'd seen his picture and knew he was ex-Mr. Universe, but still I was not prepared for his bulk. My height, but a 50-inch chest. Life had got to him, though, and booze. I could see it in his face and smell it on his breath. He was still big, but soft and flabby now, maybe 10, 20 pounds over his best. He needed to shave, his eyes were red, and he wasn't cheerful.
What do you want?
Lance Kite?
What about it?
Mind if I ask a few questions? It's private business. Can we talk inside?
I talk good right here.
I'm trying to get some information about Louis Charnock. I believe you registered a complaint against him for the Bunko Squad. You were married to Monica Moore at the time.
Who are you?
Name's Roper, private investigator. I understand she left you for Charnock. I'm trying to find out if he's on the level of running a racket. I'd like to nail him. You wouldn't mind that, would you?
I'd have to think about it.
Okay, no hurry. I heard you dropped your complaint suddenly. Mind telling me why?
Sure. It's none of your business. Is that clear enough?
Fine. First rate. Thanks for your time.
Now, hold it. Hold it. Did Monica send you?
Monica?
No, but you seen her around.
Yes.
Maybe you'll see her again, eh? Maybe you can give her a message for me.
Maybe.
Okay. Give her this.
A heavily muscled 20-inch arm launched from deep in his living room in a long, sweeping arc at my chin. It should have torn my head off, but my old judo and karate instructor had prepared me well for just such chance encounters. I moved my head to the right and used left forefist upper block, revolving my blocking arm in a short counter arc. Inverted fist strike to the spleen, and Kite sagged and retched. I caught all the fumes from his morning's worth of beer. He was set up perfectly for a rising elbow strike, but I was fascinated by his long, vulnerable jaw and tagged him on it to find out if it was glass. It was. And Kite sat down with a look of hurt surprise. I dropped my business card under his gaping mouth. Drop around and see me, Kite, when you feel better. A woman had come out of a neighboring apartment. She stood staring, disbelieving how anyone could drop an ex-Mr. Universe. I summed it up for her in one word. Incentive. Box office in the Wilshire Park Playhouse. The attendant hesitated when I asked where Mr. Charnock was living while in town. I explained it concerned a large donation to his cause. I got the address. The Regency Arms is a good apartment hotel off Wilshire along the old Miracle Mile. The clerk told me Charnock had the penthouse. A small self-service elevator worked its way to the top. The suite had double doors. A big, burly man filled the threshold. His hair was close-cropped, yellow. He had a flat, dented nose, scar tissue over his eyes and ears, an ex-pug, wrestler, or bouncer. I recognized him as the man driving the limousine the night I saw Monica Clayton and Charnock in the car after his lecture. I handed the bouncer-cum-butler my business card. It read, Anthony Hale, attorney at law. Tell Mr. Charnock about a donation Mrs. Casper may have called. It concerns her estate. I'll wait. Big Bruiser didn't say a word. Just walked across the sitting room to a closed door at the far end, knocked, and entered. While I waited, I studied the brochures on psychic power and cosmic thoughts and was deep in reading how to create my own good luck when the door opened. The Bruiser summoned me by tilting his anvil-shaped head.
Mr. Hale, it's difficult for me to see people without an appointment. My time is limited. There are so many in need.
I understand, Mr. Charlie, but the matter of Mrs. Casper's estate concerns you. I have with me an affidavit signed by Mrs. Casper.
Mrs. Casper, I don't believe I've seen her name in our guest book.
The matter of her will is a sensitive, and I'm sure you understand. There's the utmost need for discretion.
You say that Mrs. Casper has come to my lecture?
Many times, but she's never given her correct name. Family, you understand?
Yes, but why all this caution?
Very well. Quite bluntly, Mrs. Casper does not have long to live. Her death is not only predictable, but imminent. Her bequest to you is to be anonymous because the present heirs would not welcome this dispersal of the estate they somehow conceive of being their rightful inheritance.
Well, that presents no problem.
But there was a good deal of notoriety about that other woman once, wasn't there? Let's see. Her name was, Monica Moore, yes. The former movie star. The matter of her husband's contesting the disposal of her monies. Remember, it was all in the papers, Mr. Charnock.
One moment, please. Our cosmic thoughts are not in tune. Let me concentrate a moment. No, this is a difficult matter. Perhaps you should speak to my associate.
Don't bother, Lewis. It's a waste of time. The gentleman will be leaving.
The voice on the intercom belonged to the man who now stood in the doorway. Doran, the organist, business manager, general factotum for Charnock. Alongside him was the bruiser.
It says Anthony Hale on this card. There must be some mistake. The name is Roper, isn't it?
Whatever gave you that idea?
The cosmic mind.
I started to close the snap on the attaché case on my knees. The gun changed my mind. I handed the case over to Dorn. He opened it, lifted out the small tape recorder, switched the on button to rewind, spun the tape, wiped it out. He nodded to the bruiser, who fell in 2 steps behind me. With his gun in my ribs, I went obediently to the elevator. But as I left Charnock's office, I could hear a slapping sound and an exclamation of pain. The gun prodded my back. As the elevator door closed and I started down, I thought back to that brochure about making your own good luck. Guess I hadn't read enough of it. Well, you win one, you lose one. I called Allie Riegel to see if he had any news about Pam Clayton, the missing heiress.
She's still missing, unless you managed to find her.
Well, they told me at the Gilded Cuckoo she never kept her beauty appointment Monday morning, that in fact she didn't even have one. Incidentally, is that spa legit?
Yeah, as far as I know.
Allie, I'm batting zero. Come up with something, anything.
Well, Penny Rich has complained that their house had been broken into and ransacked again.
Again? Well, when did it happen before?
A few nights before Willie was knocked off.
2 break-ins?
Uh-huh.
Hmm. Sounds like Willie had something somebody wanted and still wants. If he knew about it and didn't let on, then he had a pat hand and was sitting tight. Maybe we finally have something, Allie. Motive. I hung up and wondered if the first ransacking of Willie's house had been the reason for his calling me. It was a new element to consider. I thought about that and suddenly thought about something else I should have thought about and hadn't. I called the Gilded Cuckoo, but the regular receptionist wasn't there. The gal I talked to had just been transferred from therapy. I remembered her. The regular girl, Bonnie Burns, was on vacation, she said. Left Monday. I explained it was important that I reach her and got her address. Tahoe, the Totem Lodge. Pamela Clayton have an appointment at the Cuckoo Monday morning, Labor Day?
Sure. Monday's her standing appointment. Hairstyling with Mr. K. She came in right on time.
Oh. Then a Mr. H. Masson didn't take her place?
No, never heard of him.
Uh-huh. Well, was Mrs. Clayton ever a patient under treatment for anything?
You'd have to ask Mr. Glendon about that. We're not allowed to discuss...
I'd like to fly up there tonight, get a statement from you.
Tonight? Crazy. I look forward to it.
Bonnie, do you always take your vacation at this time?
No, but I was overdue, and all of a sudden they said business was slow and I should take off.
Would that be Mr. Glendon?
Yes. You know him?
When did he decide it was all right for you to start your vacation?
It was Monday, Labor Day, right after lunch. Hey, you sound sexy. Ask me the questions when you get up here. You, look as good as you sound?
Better not depend on it.
Try cabin 5 when you get here. We'll find out.
When I got to the Totem Lodge, cabin 5 had the light on and the door open. It seemed a nice, hospitable gesture. I knocked on the door. Bonnie? I got that odd, cold feeling and walked in. I took Pam Clayton's photo from my pocket and was disturbed by her resemblance to Bonnie Burns. Same age, similar coloring. They could have passed for sisters. I stared at a blonde wig set up on her dressing table and wondered if she'd worn it recently. She wasn't wearing it now. Bonnie Burns was a redhead, and the redhead was dead. Sprawled on the floor in a pool of her own blood. A long knife buried in her back. The local sheriff's office said they'd get a man out. I flushed the cab to the airport and learned there'd been earlier flights out to Reno, San Francisco, and Vegas. The killer needn't have waited around for me, but I had the feeling, one of those feelings, that the killer would be on my flight back to L.A. The plane was fueling up on the runway. Six other passengers boarded the plane, two women, four men. One of the women had the seat next to her piled high with bags, baskets, containers of all sorts. I put her down as a grandmother visiting a newly married daughter with a lot of groceries for the family. The second woman was dark and bulky, her face half covered with a scarf and wearing a thick, high-collared coat. She constantly hummed and talked to herself as she stared out the seat window. She had a big ball of wool on the seat and knitting needles, scissors, and magazines. Another nut going to join the relatives. I spoke to the men, an elderly reverend gentleman, long retired from the cloth, he said, out of Tahoe City. The second was a chubby salesman of electric lighting fixtures who had negotiated a big deal on animated neons with the large casinos. The third, a ranger from Sequoia National Park, quitting the service after 20 years. The fourth was a saturnine dental surgeon from San Diego who said he was dying of cancer at 43. He looked older. I was the seventh passenger, the only one aboard who looked like a murderer. Well, sometimes those feelings are wrong. I knew I had the feeling, but maybe this was one of those times. When we put down at L.A. International, the women got off first. The one with the groceries headed for the first phone booth. The humming eccentric with the knitting needles went for the ladies' room. The retired reverend and the ranger picked up their luggage from the spinning drop in the baggage room. The lighting salesman grabbed his briefcase and headed for the bar. The dental surgeon and I went directly to the exit and cab stands. I let him have the first one that came along because he was dying and in more of a hurry. I got back to my apartment and smelled whiskey and trouble. The door had been forced, the living room attacked by a strong, bad-tempered visitor. I knew who, even before I found the note from Lance Kite on my TV set saying he'd get back to me. I pulled the place more or less together, had a few drinks, and went to bed. Even in my dreams, I ran around, knocking on the wrong doors, bumping into things, stumbling over dead bodies. Willie kept following me, asking me when I was going to solve his murder.
Lieutenant Camino.
Lieutenant, Max Roper. Did Captain Scott from Bunko fill you in?
Oh, yeah, Roper. Have you turned up anything?
Another corpse. Young woman, hunting knife in her back. Happened last night, up in Tahoe.
Why the hell did you call me sooner?
Well, that's Placer County, out of your jurisdiction. And I was wondering if you'd check out the blade. Hunting knife, ivory handle. Not Johnny Cashew's usual style.
Yeah, but... I can check him out for you. What else?
Louis Charnock.
Has he killed anybody?
I'd like to believe it. But so far, he just seems guilty of perpetrating fraud. I'm getting nowhere fast on this caper. Can't seem to close in.
Well, what do you expect, Hotshot? You want to break it in 3 days? You know better than that. Get off your tail. Do some legwork.
Jim Kilburn was one of the new breed of young whiz 10%ers, an agent who handles athletes. Willie Rich had been one of his superstars.
Come on, who'd want to kill Willie? Look at the file I've got on him. How much money he made for how many owners.
You make a good point, Kilburn, but there are other factors. What about the disappearance of Clayton's daughter?
I don't see the connection.
Well, she and Willie Rich had been seeing each other.
So what? I took her out a couple of times.
Well, you're not married. Willie was.
You're saying Penny could have done it? Forget it.
Business managers have been known to pick up an extra few bucks with clients' money. Maybe you did it.
Maybe I did, but I can't seem to remember the reason. All right, I'll tell you one thing. Willie and I were discussing money these days because he didn't want to ride for Clayton anymore. He was willing to buy back the advance and the contract.
When did he tell you this?
About a month ago, before the Del Mar meeting started. Willie could have made over $1 million if he cared to ride what was available, and I'd make my 10%, of course. I think he was bored, been riding too long. Why would I kill him? I made money off of him.
Did anybody else know Willie didn't want to ride anymore?
No, and not to my knowledge, not even Clayton.
Where were you on Labor Day, Kilburn?
Not killing Willie. I was in San Francisco negotiating a deal.
All day? All night?
What hours are you interested in? I understand he was killed at 10. I was at L.A. International at 8:05. That left me just enough time to fly down to Escondido and knock Willie off in his pool.
Possible. I know you fly your own plane, but I guess you didn't because you had a previous engagement, hmm?
Correct.
You're not going to tell me it was with Pam Clayton.
I'm not telling you another damn thing.
How high up are we?
23 floors. Why?
Either you tell me where you were after 8 Monday night, or I'm going to throw you right out the window.
What are you, some kind of psycho?
Let's find out, shall we?
No, wait. I'll tell you, but Look, I wouldn't want it to get around.
My lips are sealed.
If this gets out, I will sue you for defamation.
I'm waiting, Kilburn.
I was at the Golden Grotto.
Oh, I didn't know you were gay.
I'm not. I needed Jess Haywood's signature on a contract.
You mean Haywood, the quarterback?
I swear, if you spread this around...
One more thing. Did Willie ever go to the Gilded Cuckoo, that spa in Poway?
Yeah, I think so, once in a while, to take off a few pounds. What's the connection?
Maybe Bonnie Burns, a receptionist. I found her murdered last night up at Lake Tahoe. Knife in her back.
Oh, my God. Look, I wish I could help you. I really do. Here, take this list. People Willie worked for. You know, wins, losses.
Kilburn was the color of wet chalk. I left him frantically mopping his brow. There are a lot of owners and trainers on the list he gave me with better records than Tyler Clayton, but Clayton was the only one whose daughter vanished the same day that Willie drowned, and that fact sent me back to the Clayton estate. I eased into the driveway and was starting for the front door. I ducked low, ran around a thick hedge toward the sound of shots. Tyler Clayton stood facing a small outdoor shooting range, firing in a full front dummy. I watched his face. He enjoyed it. I got the impression, the feeling, that Tyler Clayton could kill with no trouble at all.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Princess Stakes Murder. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow, and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.